Okay, good morning. My name is Tamar Basar. I'm the director of CAS, the Center for Advanced Study, and I welcome you all to this symposium, which is the inaugural symposium, which is organized by our center. And the purpose is to showcase the recent research of selected faculty who were affiliated with the center last year as well as this year, and as associates and fellows. So this is a diverse group of presenters coming from several different disciplines across campus. More precisely, we have 14 speakers coming from 13 different departments. And presentations will be based on their projects funded by the center through release time appointments. The back cover of this program booklet provides information on the center itself and its activities and so on. So I won't repeat what's there, already there, but what I want to emphasize is that the Associates and Fellows Program is a signature activity of the center in accordance with its mission of supporting the extraordinary human and physical resources of the University of Illinois through encouragement and promotion of exemplary scholarship in all areas of knowledge. I want to emphasize this qualifier, the all areas. It cuts across all campus. The faculty you'll hear from in the symposium, they come from different corners of campus. They were awarded on a competitive basis appointments at the center to pursue innovative and path-breaking research, writing, and performance projects. In addition to these speakers, you will also hear from a panel of directors of four interdisciplinary institutes and centers that shape our diverse and multidisciplinary research landscape. Now, talking about the landscape, research landscape, and our research enterprise, we now come to the opening of this symposium, and we are very fortunate to have our Vice Chancellor for Research, Peter Schiffer, here, who is leading this research enterprise on campus. Let me just say a few words on Peter's background. He's a professor of physics, and he is, as I indicated, a vice chancellor for research on our campus. And he leads the university's close to 750 million research enterprise. In this role, provides leadership for campus-wide interdisciplinary research institutes, promotes new research initiatives, and oversees the administrative and business processes that ensure the productive, safe, and ethical conduct of research at Illinois. Before joining Illinois, Peter served in a number of administrative faculty and research roles at Penn State University, and prior to that, he was on the faculty of the University of Notre Dame, and also did postdoctoral work at AT&T Bell Labs. He received a BS from Yale University and a PhD from Stanford. His personal research as a condensed matter experimental physicist focuses on artificial spin ice, geometrically frustrated magnets, and other magnetic materials. It's a pleasure to invite Peter to the podium to formally open the symposium.
All right, thank you, Tamir. That's a very, very kind introduction. And thank you for all coming out for this inaugural CAS Spring Symposium. It's wonderful to see a large number of distinguished members of our community here on a damp spring morning when I know the semester is rising to a crescendo and there are all sorts of other exciting and important things that are going on. The provost in particular, but the chancellor and I also, talk about Illinois as the preeminent public research university with a land grant mission and global impact. What this means to me is that we have a unique breadth of expertise. We have world-renowned researchers covering the spectrum from, you know, everything from literature to astronomy to core subjects in engineering to agriculture to the life sciences to history, the social sciences. We cover it all, and we do it in a way that is leading the world. And that's something very special about the University of Illinois. And what makes it special is not just the fact that we bring in big grants, although we do, and I'm happy when we do. And it's not just that our faculty and our students and our alums win big awards, because they do, of course. What's special about it are really the faculty here. The individual faculty members are leading the world in thought and in action. They are truly making a difference through exploring the universe, whether it be the universe of human interactions or philosophical thought, or whether it be in the STEM fields trying to solve the mysteries of the universe or figuring out how to resolve a particularly difficult technical problem in electronics or out on the farm. It's something that we as faculty members do. And that's what I see as being very special in this inaugural symposium, is that we're bringing together the faculty who are truly excellent from across the campus and really making a difference by bringing them together and showcasing to each other, quite frankly, the breadth of the spectrum of our expertise and our accomplishments. Now, this wouldn't be possible without the Center for Advanced Study. The CAS provides recognition. I believe this comes from the initial statement of the purpose of the CAS way back in the late 50s, provides recognition to scholars of the highest distinction and provides incentive for the highest level of scholarly achievement. And CAS, as Tamir indicated, is unique certainly on this campus, but probably across the nation, in that it fosters scholarship across the entire spectrum of the university. And this is something very special. I mean, it would be special on any campus, but particularly at the University of Illinois, where we are so good in so many areas that it, you know, to have one organization that brings people together, gets them talking to each other, and helps foster excellence, that's a unique mission, and something that CAS has done for a long time, and that the symposium in particular is doing now. So those of you in the audience, those of you who are participating, you will see that today and tomorrow. The breadth of speakers really does demonstrate the breadth of our campus, shows all kinds of great things going on. You've got the program in front of you, but you can see, if I take a look at it, you've got, everything from history, classics, and political science to physics, chemistry, and computer science. It really runs the full gamut. And then there also is the initial panel discussion here with our distinguished institute directors who will be talking about one of the key drivers of excellence at Illinois, which is the large interdisciplinary institutes. And they are very, very well represented by the panel members here. So let me just conclude by first saying thank you to Tamir, to the CAS staff for pulling this together, to all of the speakers and panelists who are going to be sharing a little bit of what they do with the people in the audience today, and to everybody who came out on a damp morning at a busy time of year to learn and contribute to the breadth of excellence we have on campus. I'm looking forward to hearing what I can of the full spectrum of what's going on. I'm going to apologize in advance, because the Chancellor tapped me to go to an administrative meeting that will be much, much, much less interesting than anything that gets said here, and yet I will go there. So if you see me walk out in a few minutes, it's not because I'm uninterested, it's because I've got to go do another little thing. So thank you again to everybody for being here and for participating, and have a great couple of days.
Thank you, Peter, also for your support of the center. And I know that you're a true believer in the mission of the center and its place on this campus. We'll move on to the panel, but let me just say a few words first. Our campus, as Peter has also indicated, is a very long history of multidisciplinary and interdisciplinary research. And the best indication of this is the existence of several centers and institutes that bring together faculty and researchers from diverse disciplines and cause the creation of new knowledge and technology. And nothing can be more proper than kicking off the symposium with a panel of directors of some of our campus's most important institutes and centers to discuss interdisciplinary research at Illinois. All these institutes and centers, namely the Beckman, IGB, IPRH, and NCSA, offer the opportunity for researchers from different fields to be brought together in a setting that encourages conversation across multiple disciplines. So the panelists I'm delighted to introduce our directors as panelists, Dianne Harris, Art Kramer from Beckman, Dianne from IPRH, Gene Robinson, IGB, and Ed Seidel, NCSA. Let me just give a little bit of background on each panelist, and then we'll move on to this table and start the discussion. Dianne Harris is an architectural, landscape, and urban historian, and she's the director, and she has been since 2008 of the Illinois Program for Research in the Humanities, and she's also a professor of landscape architecture with affiliate appointments in the School of Architecture, the program in art history, the Department of History, the program in Jewish studies, and in the Graduate School of Library and Information Science. She holds a PhD in architectural history from the University of California, Berkeley. Her scholarship, which has a broad temporal and geographic research spanning from the 18th century Lombardy to the post-war United States, is marked by a constant interest in the relationship between the built environment and the construction of racial and class identities. She's particularly well known for her scholarly contributions to the study of race and space. Art Kramer is the director of the Beckman Institute for Advanced Science and Technology, and as of June 2010, or since June 2010, and is also Swanland Chair and Professor of Psychology and Neuroscience. He received his PhD in cognitive experimental psychology right here from Illinois in 1984. His research is focused on cognitive psychology, cognitive neuroscience, aging, and human factors, and particularly on the understanding and enhancement of cognitive and neuroplasticity across the lifespan. His research has been featured in a long list of print, radio, and electronic media, including New York Times, The Wall Street Journal, Washington Post, and so on, too numerous to list here. Gene Robinson, our third panelist, is the director of the Karl Worse Institute for Genomic Biology. He joined Illinois in 1989 and holds a Swanland Chair and is also the Center for Advanced Study Professor of Entomology. He also holds affiliate appointments in the Department of Cell and Developmental Biology, the Program in Ecology, Evolution and Conservation Biology, and the Beckman Institute. His PhD is from Cornell, and over the years he has received many prestigious awards and recognitions, among which are the NIH Pioneer Award, the Guggenheim Fellowship, and election to the American Academy of Arts and Sciences and the National Academy of Sciences. His current research is on using genomic and molecular systems biology approaches to understand how genes influence social behavior. One focus is to discover how social evolution has sculpted the brain's reward systems. And the fourth panelist is Ed Seidel, who is the director of NCSA. In addition to leading NCSA, he's also a founder professor in the Department of Physics and is a professor in the Department of Astronomy. His previous leadership roles include serving as the Senior Vice President for Research and Innovation at the Skolkovo Institute of Science and Technology in Moscow, directing the Office of Cyber Infrastructure, and serving as Assistant Director for Math and Physical Sciences at NSF, and leading the Center for Computation and Technology at Louisiana State University. He also led the Numerical Relativity Group at Max Planck Institute for Gravitational Physics in Germany at the Albert Einstein Institute. His PhD is from Yale University and in relativistic astrophysics, and his research is in high-performance computing and relativity and astrophysics has been recognized. His research in these areas has been recognized by a number of awards. The way we are going to structure the discussions at the panel is that we have three questions that the panelists will be addressing. And so let me just give you a glimpse of these questions. And in fact, in your program booklets is a loose sheet, or there is also a separate loose sheet which you can have. These questions have been printed. The first question is each panelist will provide an overview of his or her center or institute, and then address the question of what's the range of disciplines represented by the unit, and what's the composition of faculty and researchers across these disciplines, as well as in terms of permanent, temporary, and visiting appointments. The second question is, are cross-disciplinary intersections established primarily at the discretion of the individual researcher, or does your unit encourage these interactions, and if so, how? And the third one is, has your center or institute established collaborations with other interdisciplinary units on campus or elsewhere? Are there barriers that need to be overcome? What's the net benefit of to campus of such collaborations, and how important is it for interdisciplinary research to be a permanent fixture of our campus landscape? And we will go in a round robin fashion. Each panelist will address the questions one at a time. And then at the end, we will have time for questions from the audience. We will be taking questions from the audience. So at this point, I would like to invite the panelists to the table.
Fellows, we have faculty fellows and graduate students fellows who spend a year with us. Faculty get a semester release time. Graduate students get a stipend, and everybody participates throughout the year in our fellows seminar that meets once every 2 weeks, typically, to discuss somebody's work in progress. That's been probably the greatest privilege of my career here at Illinois, has been to sit at that table with those fellows and reading about their fantastic work. Watching our faculty and graduate students, no matter what discipline they come from, no matter what else is happening on the campus, watching them all roll up their sleeves and do everything that they can to help advance the work of a colleague. It's really a phenomenal experience. And what we've done when we've selected fellows at IPRH over the years is worry a whole lot less about what their what department they come from and what their disciplinary affiliation is than about the nature of the project. If the project is in any way seeming to be humanities and arts inflected, it's an IPRH project. So we don't say, this person's from psychology, that's kind of social science-y, they can't be part of us. No, we look at what they're doing, and we've had faculty and graduate student fellows from a very broad range of colleges and departments on this campus. So although the core of the humanities faculty on our campus obviously reside in both Fine and Applied Arts and the College of Liberal Arts and Sciences, we've had fellows from a very wide-ranging set of disciplines. And our umbrella, in fact, is a very, very big umbrella, and we operate with a very small budget. Our footprint is far beyond our resources. So the range of disciplines is very broad. The composition of faculty and research across those disciplines, very broad. We don't have permanent appointments. We are a non-curricular unit. We house no faculty, but we do have the fellows, and we have postdoctoral fellows thanks to grants from the Andrew W. Mellon Foundation. And those postdoctoral fellows have been terrific in terms of being able to energize the community and the conversations that happen around that fellow seminar table and in bringing all kinds of interesting ideas to the IPRH. We've become increasingly, and I'm going to stop in just a minute because I think I'll be going into question two, but we've become increasingly broad, I think, in the ways that we've thought about what happens at the IPRH over the past 17 years, reaching out to work across campus and partner with other centers and institutes. So I think it's been a place where the mission has stayed the same in the sense that it's been consistently about doing everything we can to support the work of our outstanding humanities and arts faculty while simultaneously seeing that what that means has been a pretty rapidly shifting landscape. With that, I'll stop and pass the baton.
Okay, to Art.
Thanks. Well, I'd like also to thank Tamir for inviting me here to represent the Beckman Institute. I've been a member of the Beckman Institute since the day the doors opened in 1989. As many of you know, it was funded largely, at least 80% of the funding, from Arnold and Mabel Beckman, and Arnold started out here and got his master's degree in 1923 before going on to Caltech to get a PhD in another 3 years, become a faculty member briefly, and start what became Beckman Instruments. The research groups, and there are a number of them, were initially selected by Ted Brown. He was our founding director and the vice chancellor for research, and a committee of faculty members. And the main theme, and it has evolved, I think all of the institutes evolved, was really based on the notion of intelligence, both carbon and silicon based. So there was a physical science side and a life science side. And that's come together in many ways, but we do represent faculty and students from 53 departments in 11 colleges, most of physical science, life science, behavioral science, engineering, and we have a few folks from the humanities and the performing arts and the law school, so we are very broad. The themes that we focus on now are micro and electronic nanostructures, biological intelligence, human-computer interaction, intelligent human-computer interaction, and imaging, mostly bioimaging. But since we're not a traditional department, we have the ability to change, I wouldn't say extremely quickly, but quickly. And half the Beckman Institute is being reorganized now as we speak. We have reviews about every 5 years. Nobody has tenure in the Beckman Institute. And I do remember Peter, when he took over as VCR, asking me, so who have you gotten rid of at the Beckman Institute who was no longer interdisciplinary and very productive? And I had that all prepared. And I said, well, you know, after we started, I think 3 years in, we got rid of a whole bunch of physicists, Peter, just like you, because they didn't play well with others. And we continue to do that. I mean, we have these evaluations. There is no tenure. So people come and go, but some people have been there a while. We have full-time, part-time, and affiliates. And what that means in the Beckman Institute is really a matter of how much of your life you spend there. The full-time faculty members have all of their lab, their students, their postdocs in the institute, and there are about 60 of those. The part-time have often shared space, much like IGB, which is a lot of shared space, and Jean will tell you about that. And the affiliates are faculty members who want to try out the place and see how it goes on both ends, both the faculty and the Beckman Institute. So I was thinking a question I wanted to pose at this time is, so why join the Beckman Institute? What's the value added as compared to being in your home departments and colleges? And I think there are a number of values and a number of perks. We might think of them as that. I think number one, you have great colleagues and students who really value collaboration and interdisciplinary research. My favorite place to really learn about what's going on in the Beckman Institute is the cafeteria at lunch. Wonderful things happen there. A lot of interdisciplinary research has been planned and started out there when a theoretical physicist sits down with a chemist, a neuroscientist, even a performing artist. Rick Powers used to spend a lot of time in the Beckman Institute, an English professor. So you never know who you'll meet. We have great support in centralized facilities and microscopy, and we do coordinate, that's another question, with IGB in terms of making sure we don't spend money that we shouldn't spend so that we're well coordinated across institutes. Virtual reality, and I know I saw Donna sitting up there, she's been involved in that in the past, as well as biomedical imaging. Some of you may know that when Paul Lotteber was here, he started the Biomedical Imaging Center in terms of MRI, but it's expanded greatly since. We also have Beckman Fellows, and that's the real important part of the legacy of Arnold and Mabel Beckman, the acknowledgement that young people are really critical in what we do in these institutes. And we have about 5 or 6 new Beckman Fellows who are postdoctoral fellows, 3-year program, money for travel. It's a great fellowship program. We select every year out of about 80 to 100 applicants. So it's very, very selective, and it occurs across these 53 departments and 11 colleges. But we also have graduate students. I just got to select, based on the input from a committee, 7 of them last week, and they spend a year in the Beckman Institute collaborating across labs, and we have senior fellows, so we don't ignore the developed individuals, the faculty members. We provide seed grants. I think that's another perk, both in collaboration with the campus, but also when we're able to, and Tamir did the same thing when he was Beckman director, when we're able to put away a couple of bucks here and there, we offer seed grants to get faculty members together to do new things. And we also have a number of centers, more and more all the time, within the Beckman Institute that are funded from NIH, EPA, IARPA, and a number of other agencies. So that's the Beckman Institute in a nutshell. Thanks.
Thank you. Gene?
Okay, so the IGB is kind of the new kid on the block. We're the newest institute. We are 8 years old. We were started with a special allocation from the legislature, $75 million, to build the building. And then the campus responded with a hiring initiative in the areas of genomics and allied bioinformatics fields. There was a sense by some pioneers on campus, Chip Zukoski, then the Vice Chancellor for Research, Harris Lewin, then the director of the Keck Center for Functional and Comparative Genomics, a service center, and the late Charles Miller, the founding director of the School of Molecular and Cellular Biology, who really led the development of the institute. There was a sense that biology was on the threshold of a revolution due to genomics, and that Illinois would be very well positioned to lead in this because of the breadth of our campus activities in the life sciences, the strength of our engineering, and the connections that we hope to be able to form with social sciences. So the institute was formed, and I think it is starting to live up to its promise, just as the field of genomics is also starting to live up to its promise. The range of disciplines that are represented in the IGB is very broad. We have faculty, there's a total faculty number of about 70, and then another 70 or so affiliates, structured similarly to the way the Beckman is structured. They represent 8 colleges and over 30 departments. And then these are extraordinary faculty in addition to extraordinary staff, graduate students, and postdocs. The range of disciplines represented is broad. The portfolio of research is very broad, and it fits the landscape of a land-grant university. So there are research activities in the area of health, activities in the area of environment, agriculture, and fundamental approaches as well in the areas of environment, origin of life, and so forth. So I mentioned that the faculty exist in terms of core faculty and affiliate faculty, as in the case of the Beckman. And in fact, you'll notice throughout the presentations this morning on the panel, a lot of similarities in that we took a lot of the structure from the Beckman as one of the oldest, if not the oldest, multidisciplinary institutes on an academic campus in the country. And so we were able to benefit from some of the structure that worked well and learn from some of the problematic areas. One area that we all struggle with, and I think is appropriate to think about in a multidisciplinary context today, and it relates actually to our second category of faculty, are the affiliates. So we are organized, as I'll tell you about when we get to the answers to question two, so stay tuned. We are organized strictly on a team basis, and there are some serious issues raised with respect to assistant professors and team science. How do you ensure that assistant professors are able to develop their careers in accordance with the dominant model of evaluation, which, as I call it, is the Lone Ranger model? How do you align that with the imperatives and the structure of team science? So to recognize that tension, we have primarily a category of affiliate faculty. They are primarily, not exclusively, primarily assistant professors who are able to, as Art says, participate on a more limited way as they are developing their own career. And I think that's something that we try to deal with, how to incorporate, how to include the young faculty that come with great ideas, great enthusiasm, the latest techniques, how to incorporate them in a team science based based approach. So I'll stop there.
Okay, thanks, Jim. Ed?
Okay, thanks. So I actually have a presentation. Let's see here. Don't worry, this is all the questions. I'm gonna be quick.
Okay.
There we go. Okay, starting here. So I very methodically went through the directions and followed them carefully, which is not normal for me, but I've done that anyway. So just to say a few words about the center itself of NCSA, it goes back to a period of time in their early 80s when simulation and modeling were beginning to, the hints of an early revolution, let's say, were occurring in many disciplines, particularly in physics, but in many other areas as well. And that's led finally to where we are today, where we have very large computing environments that are needed to do work in all areas of science and increasingly in social sciences and even in the humanities. And also the data-intensive revolution, which is expanding, I would say, even rather faster than the traditional simulation modeling community. But to me, they are all blended together. And NCSA has been established initially as one of five supercomputing centers that the NSF decided to fund starting around 1984 and 1985. And it's been the leading center, I would say, in the country over three decades. So today, NCSA is a research and development unit on the campus just up by University Avenue. It is currently having about 200 staff, very expert staff in every aspect of high performance computing, networking, software development, data intensive science, and so on. It has two facilities, the one on the, I'm not keeping up. Here we go. That was what I was looking at on my computer. So it has about 200 staff who are expert in every aspect of high-performance computing and networking and so on, and very importantly, the youth. So NCSA stands for the National Center for Supercomputing Applications, and my mantra is that the letter A is the most important letter in our name. It has the most powerful system that NSF currently supports, one of the very largest systems in the world. In fact, it's by far the largest computer that Cray, the high-performance computing company, has ever built, and it's about a $345 million award to the University of Illinois. We also manage the national cyber infrastructure in a project called Exceed. It's $145 million award over 5 years to support digital services. So that particular award has no resources associated with it, no computers. It's all about people, and it's about stitching together national services across the whole country. So although NCSA is the primary institution, there are many others from San Diego to Texas to Pittsburgh and Oak Ridge and so on, so quite a few. We also have a very vibrant private sector program of about two dozen partners that bring in currently about $3 million annually. Oh, what's happening up there? Were you able to see what was
going
on?
Yes, yes,
okay,
yes.
It's
previous
disappeared.
One, you should hit the one which is...
There we go. Okay. So that's where we are. Now, so where are we going? So there are two major trends I want to point out. The first one is that we have this data and compute intensive revolution where we've gone from sort of paper and pencil to both large scale computing and also data intensive science and engineering. And then we have this idea that Gene was particularly representing, which is team science. We're going from the individual investigator. There's a typical Lone Ranger on your left, Lone Ranger scientist, Galileo, moving to teams. And in fact, that's an example. The team is a team that I once led when I lived in Europe working at the Max Planck Institute for Gravitational Physics. That was a team of PIs and postdocs and grad students across 10 countries in Europe working together in what we called the EU Astrophysics Network. So those two trends lead to what I would call interdisciplinary science, and recently there's been a National Academy study called Convergence about transdisciplinary science in the physical and biological sciences. And that Academy report, which I really strongly encourage you to look at, speaks volumes to my entire career and I think to trends for the 21st century. And that's where I'm trying to position NCSA to be a good home for in the future. So the summary of this part is, this is why I came here, was to build this environment at the University of Illinois where I felt we had the strongest ingredients to put together to build an environment where transdisciplinary team research could flourish on a background of high performance computing and data intensive science. So what are we doing then to move NCSA in this direction? So we're in the process of a deep strategic planning, and so we are reorganizing NCSA according to three primary areas. One is to create a deeply integrated scientific and computing and data environment where data and computing and software and instrumentation are to be integrated on an equal footing. So if you're a material scientist where you need electron microscopy data, data from the advanced photon source, data from simulation and modeling, software environments, you'll need all of those in order to address your problem. We're going to create that environment that integrates them all, not just around supercomputing, but whatever you need, and it typically, increasingly, is many different kinds of things. On the right-hand side, I have a box for economic development. So economic development increasingly is important, certainly for any land grant in university, and we are one of those. So we have to be very relevant to the state of Illinois and to the country. And even when I was at the NSF, I oversaw the most fundamental unit at NSF, the Director for Math and Physical Sciences. Even there, we talked a lot about economic development as the rationale for what we are. We were the foundation of the foundation, and we were the building blocks of innovation, where innovation meant economic development, you know, to first order. And then the centerpiece of this is to be a center for transdisciplinary research, where we will have faculty groups working together in teams to address complex problems. And so when you talk about the individual projects, like the Blue Waters Project or the Exceed Project and others that are funded either by NSF or locally through various kinds of grants or through funding that we have at NCSA, we will interconnect them with the theme developments and the private sector program, and they will be deeply integrated. So we have many different kinds of projects. I won't go into the details, but these range from literally hundreds of millions of dollars to $10 million projects that are funded largely by the National Science Foundation. We also have projects that are developed that are faculty-led. So for example, the Cyber GIS program, which is led by Xiaowen Wang. The ICHAS program, Institute for Computing and Humanities, Arts and Social Sciences, eDream that Donna Cox leads. These are projects that involve many different disciplines on the campus, and they're all built on a foundation of technologies. The National Data Service is a project that actually I would like to promote just a little bit here, a project where we are trying to stitch together services that support research needs of any discipline, any research area, from the humanities to the Large Synoptic Survey Telescope or the Large Hadron Collider and so on. So these projects will also be aided by the very large scale of computing, so I won't dwell on the Blue Water supercomputer, but if you just read those statistics, it is a massive machine and it is truly awesome and is enabling, most importantly, science that can't be done in any other way. It supports many different disciplines, and NCSA's had a long history of supporting all research areas of science, and so it's a great foundation for us to build on, particularly to build on the campus. We have currently six thematic areas, learning from the way IGB and Beckman are operating. where we have a theme lead, and we have currently these interim theme leads. Some of you were here, Donna, Gabrielle, and Athol, also Victor. I don't know if Xiaowen is here. I don't see Xiaowen here or Narayan. But the idea is that we're just trying to bootstrap our ways up towards a flourishing set of thematic areas, each of which is interdisciplinary. So these are not narrowly focused on, say, just general relativity, which is my background, but in physics and astronomy, we're thinking about how we would integrate optical astronomy with gravitational wave astronomy, with neutrino astronomy, with radio astronomy, and how when anyone's observing now an object in the universe like a gamma ray burst, you need to bring all of those to bear with data streams coming from all of those different channels of observation, along with simulation and modeling. So every one of these is of this type. And so right now, these are interim, where these theme leads have agreed to help us get started. And as the faculty get more engaged, these will probably move into other areas as they become specialized, and we will have more as we go forward. The idea is that within a few years, each of these will have, say, 4 to 6 faculty members, a number of postdocs, and a lot of graduate students that are running around, working together, and that will be the primary model for driving the center forward. So the research and education program at NCSA then will have these faculty-led theme leads. They will have regular meetings, a lot of brainstorming, and we also have created an academic council at NCSA where there's a bit beginnings of a governance structure for how the faculty will operate within the building. They will, of course, not be in a tenure line at NCSA. They're still members of their department, and they have to live up to both of those kinds of responsibilities. And the academic council then is advisory to the director. The faculty affiliations for long term, there are 0% appointments, again, building on the model that IGB and Beckman have. We currently have 12 core faculty. Core faculty are expected to spend some fraction of their time on a regular basis, every week if possible, in the building. We have 25 affiliate faculty. Those are also 0%, but they're members of the family. They may have a part-time office there. They may have some students or postdocs who live there. And they're welcome to come and work with us and help and build up the intellectual environment there. And we also have 16 Blue Waters professors. Some of them are overlapping with the other kinds of faculty. The Blue Waters professors are sort of like an endowed chair, where rather than having an endowment you have of money, you have an endowment of computer time. So you're able to use the Blue Waters facility, which is unique in the country for large-scale computation. We also have 11 NCSA staff, it goes the other way too, who are adjunct faculty in various departments across the country, I mean across the campus. We have research fellows, also a short-term program, where we fund at the level of about $25,000 small projects that go on for a year, and we just announced 13 new ones across all areas of the campus, FAA, LAS, GISLIS, and engineering. And we start a colloquium series, and that's been every week actually this last year, where we've brought great speakers that help help tell people what's going on across the country. News flash, we're working very hard with different departments across the campus to recruit great new faculty. We have 5 that are confirmed in the last year and a half since I've been here, year and a quarter, that have come to Illinois into various departments, I think in large part because of NCSA. That is, we've helped recruit them. I wouldn't take all the credit for it, but I think we were a critical part of their thinking about whether or not this is a good place for them. And we have 5 more that we're currently negotiating with, and I hope we'll get them all to come across the whole campus. I will point out, I'm not synchronized here, of course, almost finished here. People talk about the north-south divide, Green Street, north of Green and south of Green. We don't really see that. We have faculty in many different areas from crop science. We're currently jointly recruiting 3 faculty with the College of Education. The College of Education is recruiting a lot of people with PhDs in computer science these days, as many departments are. So that line is not there for us. And I think I'm done for my first question. Thank you.
Thank you. Well, you can continue with question 2.
Oh, I get to keep going.
Yes.
Okay. I will do that.
We'll be moving in the other direction.
All right. So question 2 is more on, are the cross-disciplinary interactions established primarily at the direction of the individual researcher? And how do we encourage these interactions? So, just backing up, at the national level, NCSA has been supporting teams for 3 decades to do their science. And typically, Back in the early 90s, I was actually here. I came here in 1989 as well, and my career was completely transformed by my time at the Beckman Institute. So I used to work very narrowly in the area of mathematical relativity. And so as some mathematicians have told me, you don't need a team to prove a theorem. And yet I couldn't prove theorems about general spacetimes, and so computing was the only way to do it. And so I began to work in large teams. I worked with computer scientists, with mathematicians, with people expert in applied math, with people in computational science and parallel algorithms and visualization and so on, and there's no way I could know all of those things. NCSA has been doing that sort of a thing for three decades. And so it is a great framework for interdisciplinary interactions, and I think NCSA could perform a great service to this campus by building those interactions very deeply out of the strengths of the campus. And so we aim to build these research and thematic areas each around complex problems. So every one of them, you might notice they're very broad areas. So Earth and environment is about cyber GIS, it's about crop science. We're currently working with the agriculture school on recruiting a faculty member who does simulation and modeling of everything from how plants would respond to climate change to understanding how you should treat fields and so on. This fits in very well with another proposed theme within NCSA, which is around the virtual plant. And so the idea is that particular thematic area itself is going to be very interdisciplinary. And so we will then try to deeply integrate those different faculty interests that have sort of mutually interdependent needs with the expert staff at NCSA, particularly trying to free up some time from the staff so they actually will be able to integrate with the research teams. And then the grad students and postdocs will work around all of those areas to help make the connections. We will have joint themes with others. We've had many discussions with Gene at IGB on joint themes. Also with Art at the Beckman, with IC and other interdisciplinary units on the campus. We, like the other institutes, will not have long-term permanent faculty, although if they're doing very well, you could imagine they might end up staying for a decade or two if their themes continue to generate a lot of excitement, if they bring in funds, if they do very well. But they will be reviewed, and we will decide on 5-year time scales whether or not to review individual themes, I mean to renew individual themes, and whether we should bring in new ones. We support physical co-location. I think this is very important. One, I have many stories about my interdisciplinary interactions at the Beckman Institute, but I remember once thinking I had a brilliant idea, and I was writing up a physical review letter for this thing, and I talked to somebody at the water fountain. It was Lou Wicker, some of you may remember Lou, who was in atmospheric sciences, and I had this great thing I thought of, I called it causal differencing. If you're an applied mathematician, you might think of that as upwind differencing. And Lou explained to me, their community's known about this for like 30 years, and it's like trivial to them, you know? And so you need to have those kind of interactions. You need to create the mechanisms that enable that, that stir up the pot on a regular basis. So everything from cookies to water coolers to cappuccino machines to events that bring people together to policies that look at how many papers do you publish with other scientists and so on. These are the kinds of things you need to put in place. So we'll support that, as well as virtual collaboration and through shared data services, which we're working very hard on. You enable scales of collaboration that are unprecedented. So for example, around the Large Hadron Collider, you have literally tens of thousands of physicists working together around a very small number of experiments. Largely, there are two major experiments there, and they can only do this through data services that allow them to work together. So in many cases, they don't even know each other, and yet they work together. So we'd like to bring that to the campus to create data services that allow people to work together across the campus and across the country. And of course, postdocs and students form the glue. So we have this idea where we will embed these research and education areas. I'm always one behind. We have these research and education areas that draw on the different areas of the different big projects, whether it's high-speed networking or software environments, or draw on the different units across the campus, draw on different educational programs that the campus runs, and we can augment them. We won't ever replace them, but we may find ways to strengthen them. We would be an excellent venue, I think, for some interdisciplinary capstone courses, say for undergraduates. We've been thinking a lot about how we might do that. And then in our research and education program, we have a postdoc program that will be starting next year. We're going to fund a single postdoc in each of the research and education areas. They will be working across the areas, not for one particular faculty member, but for the thematic area, so they'll get an interdisciplinary experience themselves. We want to have mentoring committees for the postdocs that actually represent the different disciplines that they're embedded in, as well as joint mentoring committees for faculty. And picking up on what Jean was saying, if you have particularly young faculty that have multiple masters, they need to have a mentoring committee and to have good guidance and make sure promotion and tenure procedures represent and value the kinds of things that they're doing, because they're not lone rangers in those kind of environments. They are multidisciplinary people and they need to have special care. And we have undergraduate programs too that embed people in this environment. So I think that was the last slide that I have, just to point that out. Okay, your turn, Jean.
Thank you.
Okay, I'll just repeat the question. Are cross-disciplinary interactions established primarily at the discretion of the individual researcher at the IGB? Answer is no. Or does your unit encourage these interactions? Also, emphasis on the word encourage, the answer is no to that one as well. The reason for answering no in both cases is because our structure is actually based on mandating these interactions. So there are no individual PIs at the IGB. In order to be part of the IGB, you have to be part of a thematic research group, or theme, as we call it. So the entire structure of the IGB has been set up to mandate team science, to encourage and evaluate team science, and to judge the teams on the basis of how they accomplish this. Our social contract with the university is that we exist to provide an opportunity for individuals to come together and to do something bigger than they're able to do in their own laboratories. We ask a lot of faculty, all of these institutes do, we're stretching everyone. A common theme that you've heard is that their individual tenure lines reside in their home departments. If you look across the country, different institutes handle this differently. Here there seems to be a consistent thread where we have the tenure lines residing in the home institution, in the home department, excuse me. This creates a different set of considerations. On one hand, we're stretching the faculty, we're stretching the departments, we're causing faculty to have double lives. As Ed said, they have to live up to the responsibilities of their home department, their teaching, their committee work, their individual labs. On top of all that, we're asking them to excel and to be active in team science. And so what is the reason for that? Well, first of all, many of the best and brightest faculty are attracted to such opportunities, and so we find ourselves involved in recruitment and retention many times. And secondly, this is an opportunity to increase or facilitate the odds that faculty are able to successfully compete for large-scale multi-PI funding. I think none of us are so arrogant as to say that this is the only way that you can succeed at a multi-PI grant situation, because we know faculty are incredibly resourceful. We have many examples on campus of large team science based in home departments and based in colleges. The premise, though, is that we're making it easier. By co-locating faculty, by requiring that they form intellectual communities that meet regularly, that co-mentor students, that deal on a regular basis with each other, we're making it easier for them to have those water cooler conversations that Ed mentioned. We're making it easier for them to co-publish, and we think making it easier for them to compete in the incredibly competitive environment of the large scale funding instruments. We have 5-year review periods. We have external review panels that come in, and the instructions that I give to these panels are very simple, and that is the bottom line is that the whole has to be greater than the sum of the parts. Will you see evidence of individual faculty productivity? Of course. As I said, these institutes tend to attract the best and the brightest. That's not what we're looking at. We're looking at clear signs of the success of the group. Funding, large PI, multi-PI grants, co-authorship, co-mentorship of students. These are simple, easy to recognize metrics, and they are what we use to judge the strength and the success of the themes. There were 9 original themes that were selected 9 years ago, and we have 5 of those 9 remaining. There are a variety of reasons for why there can be turnover, but the point is that the institutes, because the tenure lines reside in the home departments, the institutes have the luxury, if you wish, of being able to have an aggressive evaluation approach that allows the institutes to try to stay at the leading edge of developments in science, try to capture new faculty as they join the faculty on campus, and create a dynamic environment.
I think as institute directors, we often look at the RFPs and BAAs that come out, and then might get together a team of researchers we know have collaborated and some who have wanted to collaborate, and think about how we might provide the support as directors to help them write a successful grant. I think we're all good at doing that, and that is part of what we do. So I do see this as a top-down, bottom-up, middle-out kind of process. I think we do it way beyond, and I know that's getting to the second question, but we do it way beyond the individual institutes. Recently, last week, I was able to meet with Malcolm Press and Adam Trickle, I think is the last name, the provost and the chancellor of the University of Birmingham. And a couple of months ago, I went over there to establish collaborations both between the Beckman Institute and the University of Illinois and the University of Birmingham. And I see some great synergies there. And we have the head of neurosurgery coming over next week, Tony Belli, who's a remarkable guy, to start collaborations within the Beckman Institute and indeed beyond the Beckman Institute. So I think these interactions happen in many ways. Again, as I've mentioned before, the cafeteria is my favorite place where they start, but we have lots of common spaces where people sit down, whether they're students or postdocs or faculty members, and just chat about what they're doing and learn about what they're doing. I didn't know Ed when he was there, but the Institute was quite new at the time. 1989 is when the doors opened, but it's been a wonderful place for me to be, and nobody was supposed to be here at the Institute for 26 years as I have, and I have a funny story about that. I was sitting at one of our reviews, and we do get reviewed about every 5 years, each of the themes, sitting in the back of the room next to a few folks from other departments, Tom Wong from Electrical Engineering, Carl Hess from Physics, and Bill Greeno from Neuroscience and Psychology. And we had an eminent reviewer like IGB. We have Nobel laureates and folks from various national academies. And this was Horst Stormer, who had a Nobel in Physics. And Horst was looking at one of our graphs, and it said, he knew the implicit rule was nobody stays there forever. We do these evaluations. And this is about 12 years ago, and he said, well, there are these 13 people that have been here since 1989. Should they be here? Should they still be here? Doesn't this violate the original bylaws? So I raised my hand and I said, well, Horst, I'm one of them, Bill's one of them, Tom's one of them, and Carl's one of them. Should we get up and leave? And he decided that wasn't a good idea. So I think some of us can be collaborative and interdisciplinary and productive for our whole careers. As I've mentioned before, we try to encourage new ideas, whether they're basic or translational, through seed grants, by providing centralized facilities that support the faculty, and first and foremost by our wonderful staff. Many of our staff members expedite the relationships, help with pre-award and post-award, and I know how good they are because they get stolen away by other institutes. And even the president of the University of Illinois took our associate director, Mike Devisel, and stole him away. So we have a wonderful staff. They really care about interdisciplinary research and supporting our students, our postdocs, and our faculty. And of course, our Beckman Fellows, I think, often provide the glue that start new programs. And when Adam and Malcolm were here last week, we were conspiring. It's always good to conspire with somebody that actually has the purse strings at their university, to start a Birmingham University of Illinois fellowship program modeled after the Beckman Institute fellowship program, in which we have young people interested in interdisciplinary research, whether in Queen Elizabeth's Hospital at Birmingham or in one of the departments in the University of Illinois, and we provide them with multiple years of support so they can bring together and they can collaborate across campuses that both have wonderful strengths that complement each other. Thanks.
Thanks.
So I think at the IPRH, the answer is also both. We really aim to support all kinds of scholarship in the humanities and arts. And so we're there to support the scholar who needs to work on his or her own, who needs to travel to an archive to do the solitary work that's so important to and that's so much at the core of many humanities projects. The scholar who just needs time to be in a library or at their desk to think and to write. This is still very much at the core. It's probably the corollary in the sciences would be the basic science that needs to get done, the bench science, right? We have absolutely essential work that we need to support in the humanities, and we certainly don't want to mess with that. And I think that at the IPRH, we really think that, again, each scholar's intellectual project is what we need to honor, respect, and support. So if someone comes in and they need that time and they need the solitude and the space to pursue their work on their own, we want to do whatever we can to support that. But we also do have a very strong bent toward interdisciplinary work, and we support that in a number of ways. And I think that it's fair to say that the structure of the IPRH has both followed and led the trajectory in the humanities toward increasingly interdisciplinary work, but interdisciplinarity in the humanities can mean many different kinds of things. So, for example, interdisciplinarity in the humanities, which is something that's certainly been very much in the conversation since at least the 1970s, when we begin to see a number of important books and articles talking about interdisciplinarity and its benefits and its pitfalls. In many cases, what that means for our humanities faculty is the importance of having conversation with people who are in allied, proximate, or even very distinct disciplines. So, for example, I remember in the early 1990s hearing the eminent environmental historian William Cronin, who's at the University of Wisconsin-Madison and who wrote a very, very important book called Nature's Metropolis, talking about the ways he did his interdisciplinary work, and he said, well, I get by with a little help from my friends, which sounded kind of facile, but in fact, I think what he's really saying is that those conversations that he was able to have with scholars in proximate disciplines and sometimes in distant disciplines have made all the difference in his ability to approach questions that necessitated moves outside of his immediate disciplinary boundaries. And so we try to facilitate those conversations whenever possible at the IPRH. And we do that, again, by creating our fellowship that is structured around themes. So every third year, we suspend the theme and have a themeless year just to kind of open things up in case anybody's feeling excluded. But typically, we've had a long history of having theme-based fellowships, and the themes also often structure at least some of the events that we construct during the year. So themes from the past have been disciplinarity, belief, difference, revolution, Publix is going to be coming up, all kinds of the means of reproduction, all kinds of very broad, capacious, in many respects, very abstract concepts that around which conversations and events get structured and that I think do help to foster a kind of interdisciplinary interaction for those who are seeking it. We also support, through limited, very modest funding, research clusters. We're now calling them research clusters. We've called them other things in the past. It's very modest funding, $2,500 per cluster. We fund up to 6 clusters. And it's really just meant as seed funding to help scholars who want to collaborate across disciplinary boundaries get together to create a modest set of events, to bring in a speaker, to help kind of establish the soil that they can help make things grow in. We also have been for the almost, I think, 17 years of the IPRH sponsoring what we call reading groups. And again, these are opportunities for faculty and students from different disciplines to get together around themes that they structure. Early modern reading groups. We have a medical humanities group. We have a digital humanities group. We have a diasporas reading group. So people who have, I think there are more than 40 of these, scholars who gather on their own in our space with no financial support, just our ability to help them gather by publicizing their interests under our umbrella. And this, I think, also has really helped some of these interdisciplinary groups to flourish. We, through this, the events that we create with our incredible staff at the IPRH, very small staff that works very, very hard, we have been creating for years now also events that help foster these kinds of multidisciplinary, interdisciplinary, and even transdisciplinary conversations. Symposia that range from things like ecological bodies a year ago to empires from below, sponsored by some colleagues in the history department. This year we brought in, just 2 weeks ago, week before last, the fifth inaugural poet of the United States, Richard Blanco, who has spent the last 25 years of his life practicing as a civil engineer before becoming the inaugural poet. He's also always simultaneously been a poet and spent some of his time here on campus talking with engineering students about the importance of poetry for practicing engineers. And I think it was a really great set of conversations over the course of the day that really helped us understand the artificial divides that we often construct and when we set up kind of disciplinary boundaries. So I think, you know, we aim to find these kinds of opportunities to foster conversations that will enhance work, whether it's done in isolation, in a library, in an archive of the more traditional mode, or being done in collaboration across disciplinary boundaries. But we've also kind of moved, I think, as the humanities nationally, internationally have moved in new directions, we've moved beyond that idea that interdisciplinarity in the humanities is just, and I don't mean that in any kind of pejorative way, I think those conversations that we have with each other are extremely important, but that it can be also more and more intensely collaborative. Again, driven by emerging intellectual projects, not coming from a top-down sense that this is what we should be doing or following other models because it's what's happening elsewhere on campus at these illustrious centers and institutes, but because the kinds of challenges, the kinds of questions that many humanities scholars are asking now demand new forms of collaboration, new forms of interdisciplinary or multidisciplinary work that really haven't happened much in the past. And I think actually we have two CAS fellows and outstanding humanities faculty in the audience with us today, Mara Wade and Harry Lieberson, both of whom are doing the kind of work that demands that kind of really intensive cross-disciplinary collaboration. Mara's been engaged for years now in a fantastic digital humanities project, Emblematica Online, funded by NEH and others to a significant level, that has demanded, I think it's fair to say, that she work with some people outside of her own discipline, that she work with folks at IChaz and elsewhere to try to do the work she wants to do. Harry's been working on global music. He's a historian of things German. So he's been looking at and working across disciplinary boundaries as well. Our Mellon grants that we've received in the last few years have helped make new kinds of collaboration possible at the IPRH. So for example, you may have heard about a $3 million grant that I received from the Mellon Foundation year before this last one to create a consortium of humanities centers and institutes across 15 institutions in the Midwest and beyond. And one of the initiatives that collaboration that Humanities Without Walls funds is cross-institutional collaboration around the broad rubric of the global Midwest. The kinds of projects that have been funded through that initiative in the first round, and there are 14 of them, include teams of scholars. Some of them are quite large teams of scholars from all of the institutions involved in the consortium. And they're working on projects that 10 or 15 years ago might not have been considered by humanities scholars. So at least two of the projects, for example, are studying issues related to the Great Lakes and climate change. We have studies of the religious soundscape of the Midwest, studies of Hmong immigrants in the Midwest, studies that have to do with food supply, with labor issues, deep histories of the environment of the Midwest. Nearly all of those projects, 13 of the 14 that were funded, involve the production of what we could call an outcome of something that is not a traditional print publication. Nearly all of those projects that we funded involve some form of digital project, digital maps, digital soundscapes, so MP3 files that have to be collected and mapped and cataloged, different kinds of multimedia publications. So this is a very exciting and different kind of development. that necessitates new kinds of collaborative models that bring up some of the things that have come up that my colleagues have raised here this morning about what happens when junior faculty in the humanities become involved in some of these funded projects that are deeply collaborative. How are we going to help their institutions understand their role that they've played as collaborators? And so that's something that we're also working on. But all this is to say that what we see is that this global Midwest rubric, which could have been interpreted and still can be interpreted in many, many, many ways, it's intentionally abstract, was formed by these groups of scholars to be this new kind of collaborative scholarship. So we're seeing this as a growing kind of trajectory in the humanities. The other fellowship that, the other grant that I just received from the Mellon Foundation in December, $2,050,000, is supporting the creation of large research groups in three areas: biohumanities, environmental humanities, and legal humanities. Again, rubrics that were not particularly well known about a decade ago and that are gaining all kinds of interest across the humanities landscape internationally. They're the kinds of rubrics that we're seeing formulated also with Mellon funding at the Consortium of Humanities Centers and Institutes, which is a fairly large national and international consortium. And I think that part of the reason we're seeing this trend toward what have been, some might call an applied humanities, but others might see differently, is a kind of interest in and an understanding that the grand challenges we face today are not solvable strictly in scientific terms. They're not solvable by any single discipline, and that in order to solve big, big, big problems like climate change, immigration, food supply, that these are problems that demand deep and very broad disciplinary collaboration, and these are topics that are increasingly of interest to folks in the humanities. Which is not to say that a historian who works on ancient Rome has no role to play in solving these problems. In fact, I would argue exactly the opposite. That these don't demand a new kind of presentism, but instead demand deeper and deeper looking at the past, at all kinds of the questions that folks in the humanities have been engaged in for many, many years. So I think what we're seeing is a kind of engagement, new kinds of engagement that are being driven by intellectual projects in the humanities that are multidisciplinary, that are deeply transdisciplinary in many respects, and for which we are fortunately able to find external funding to support. So I'll leave it at that.
This also, you have addressed question three?
Oh,
also,
would you like me, I should start with question three? Okay, sorry, you have to hear me go on for a little bit then. So we have established collaborations with other units on campus. IPRH has collaborated over the years with IChas, with GISLIS, which in its own way is a kind of interdisciplinary or multidisciplinary unit or center almost to me in my mind. With the Beckman Institute, we partnered to do a medical humanities lecture series last year, and we would love to do that some more. I'm hoping that, and I'm quite certain that our launching biohumanities group will be partnering with Gene Robinson at Beckman, and we've been in conversation with Ed and Donna Cox and Gabrielle about possible connections for IPRH and NCSA and eDream and so on. So I think that those conversations have been going on for a while. They'll probably continue. I think there's an obvious benefit to scholars, if not to campus, in these collaborations. And I think what we're all about, really, is the benefit to scholars, because we're about producing knowledge and doing better teaching with students. But barriers, I think, for us, I think I have to be frank about this. The probably the major barrier from the perspective of IPRH is funding. Our budget, you know, I've been able to bring in $6.4 million in 6 years from the Mellon Foundation, which puts us actually in the league of some of the most elite schools in this country. But our operating budget is a rounding error for any of these institutes to my right. And that's actually a significant barrier. It's quite serious because it puts the IPRH in a rather precarious position, and it's been in that precarious position for a long time. I think that You know, it's. I completely agree with my colleagues that some of the most important conversations one has are around the water cooler, the cappuccino machine, and the cookie plate. Well, we've got the water cooler. We can't afford the cappuccino machine, and we have to be really careful about buying cookies. That sounds silly, but it's actually significant. And it's my great hope, as I step down from the IPRH, that my successor will be successful in being able to find ways to make the IPRH's budget both more secure and more robust, because I think that is the fundamental barrier to its ongoing success.
Okay, thank you. Okay, in terms of collaborations, as Dianne already said, I think we all collaborate amongst ourselves and with the departments and colleges, and certainly one of the large collaborations that the Beckmans had recently was with IGB, or I should say is with IGB, on a very large grant with Abbott Nutrition. And this has actually provided support across the campus. IGB and Beckman have actually, this is before the tension was alleviated somewhat in terms of the F&A distribution, but we've distributed the overhead on the grants throughout the campus. And it really depended upon where the work was being done. Some of it in IGB, some of it in Beckman, ACES, LAS, and what have you. And I look forward to building more such relationships with Ed and Jean and your successor. By the way, congratulations.
Thank you.
And but we also do a lot of collaborations outside the University of Illinois. And I was thinking of the relations I've had, the meetings and interactions I've had with people in the last 2 months. In the last 2 months, we've started collaborations with Wright-Patterson Air Force Base, with the University of Birmingham, additional collaborations with Carle Hospital as we ramp up for the new engineering-oriented medical school. We have lots of collaborations and increasing collaborations there that focus on cancer and neuroscience with some of the neurologists and neurosurgeons and so forth. But very recently, as of last week, with MGH, or Massachusetts General Hospital, or some of you know them by the name Harvard. And we do this all the time, and we're always building new relationships with colleagues throughout the world. I know we all spend a lot of time traveling to different universities to build these relationships, and I think that's going very, very well. In terms of value gained by these institutes, they cost money. Well, maybe not all of them, but I think you should cost more. And so the university puts in a substantial amount of money to all of our cross-campus interdisciplinary institutes, but I think there are a number of values added. And one of them, and Ed mentioned this before, is recruitment and retention. And I don't know how many faculty, and not just faculty, students have come to me and said, I'm at the University of Illinois because I could be incorporated into one of these team-based research groups at the Beckman Institute. And I know it's true for every institute we have. So I think we wouldn't have the quality of the faculty and the students and the postdocs at the University of Illinois unless we had these really interesting places that people flock to, that is the cross-disciplinary institutes. So I think there's an awful lot of value added. We provide resources like supercomputers and microscopies and virtual reality and biomedical imaging, but I think more importantly, we provide the infrastructure with regard to people and ideas so that individuals can collaborate. This is an exciting place to be, and I think faculty and students still want to come here. And when I think of the quality of the students that we recruit, I have a young woman that just recently won one of these Illinois Distinguished Fellowships. I think we give out 10 to 20 a year. And two of these young people are coming to join the Beckman Institute next year. I never would have gotten into the University of Illinois if I would have had to have a perfect GPA and perfect GREs. But this is the quality of student we recruit, and they come here because of the opportunities we provide that very, very few campuses provide. Now, I think campuses can provide interdisciplinary institutes or centers, but not the breadth of what we do here, from the humanities to computing to the biological and life and behavioral sciences. It really is a wonderful place, and frankly, that's why I've been here 36 years. Thanks.
Thank you.
So the IGB does also engage in a variety of collaborations, and I'll just mention them at three different levels. Within the institute, so I mentioned that it's organized on the basis of thematic research groups or themes. Within the institute now, we're encouraging cross-theme activities, and there are a number of such initiatives underway. As an institute that has achieved middle age already, it happens quickly, we are confined by our four walls, and so the growth that we have in the Institute is based on themes reinventing themselves and new themes, but also the possibility of extending our reach within the Institute by building bridges across themes. So for that purpose, we encourage that with some social activities and also with the program of seed grants that was initiated last year, and we're looking forward to some of those seeds bearing fruit. At the campus level, we also are engaged in activities. Art mentioned one of the big ones with Beckman and IGB and Abbott Nutrition. Another one that I'll mention is the CompGen initiative. That's a partnership with the Coordinated Science Laboratory in the College of Engineering with NCSA and the IGB, and that's spearheaded by the CompGen Executive Director, Victor Jean-Ganil, who's a senior staff scientist at NCSA and is Director of Informatics at IGB. That initiative has been very successful already with a number of funded grants, including a Center of Excellence from NIH, and that's a segue to the third level, and that is IGB collaborates with other institutions across the country. So the Center of Excellence is in a new program at NIH, BD2K, Big Data to Knowledge. 11 centers of excellence were awarded, and part of the price of admission is an interest and a commitment to collaborate with the other centers. So NIH is trying rapidly to get back in or to get into the game of big data, and is mandating that the centers of excellence form an ecosystem. So we are starting to collaborate with those other centers. In addition to that, there's been a very large and well-known collaboration with Berkeley and Lawrence Berkeley Lab, funded by BP, the Energy Biosciences Center. And then another program is one of our themes, the biocomplexity theme, headed by physicist Nigel Goldenfeld. There's a large Center for the Origin of Life funded by NASA, and again, there are multiple centers within the astrobiology program at NASA, and there, so there's extensive collaboration. So you typically see scientists from the IGB then working with individuals at other institutions, a variety of video conferencing facilities to facilitate that. In terms of barriers to that need to be overcome, I'll mention three of them. One I mentioned before, and that is, how do we navigate team science with the current structure of promotion and tenure for assistant professors? I think all of us at Illinois are very sensitive to that and make sure that we do everything possible to encourage the development of the young scientist's career, even if that means that they'll be limited in their activities early on. So that's a tension that's beyond the campus. It's a large issue with respect to how science is evaluated and how promotion tenure is evaluated. Secondly, a barrier is we have to continually navigate our relationships with departments. As I said, we are stretching and in some cases stressing our faculty by having them lead these double lives. Now, of course, they only choose to do that on their own volition, but we have to constantly work together with departments to be able to make sure that we're doing it on a win-win basis, that departments are benefiting from the additional activities of their faculty outside of the department. And it should be noticed, Art mentioned, there are two specific tensions there. Art mentioned one, and that is the allocation of indirect costs, and campus stepped up after extensive study and changed the way indirect costs are distributed so that the home departments are rewarded now, and rewarded quite nicely, for the funded activities, the grants that are run by their faculty through interdisciplinary institutes. And campus did that by taking a chunk out of the central piece of ICR. So I think that says something about the commitment of the campus to interdisciplinary research. The third barrier, if you will, is just something that's on the landscape that comes and goes, and that is the ways in which funding agencies approach individual initiated science versus multidisciplinary science. And as budgets get tighter and tighter, for example at NIH or NSF, there will be different responses that different parts of these organizations have. So one institute at NIH may say, well, we want to give out more individual investigator awards rather than the large team awards, and that impacts the environment that we operate in for getting the team awards, since, as I said, IGB is based solely on the team model. So that's just something that we need to monitor, and it's dynamic. Some federal agencies increase their funding for team science, while others decrease it. And then how important is this for the campus? I'd say it was very important for the reasons that have been discussed, but let me just go one step further to say that this campus is really good at doing multidisciplinary research. We've been at it a long time, starting with the Beckman Institute. There's a strong spirit of collaboration that exists on this campus that I think all of us recognize that make it easier to launch successful enterprises of this type. And as Ed noted, the rest of the country is catching up and is paying attention and is increasingly focused on convergence, transdisciplinary research. There have now been two NRC reports at 10-year intervals on this subject. That's unusual for the National Research Council to take up the same subject with repetition, and I think it says something about the importance of this. If you read through the book that Ed recommended that you read, you will see that many of the activities and many of the precepts that are advanced in that book, we're already doing here. You've already been sitting through and hearing about those. So we are positioned very well with respect to this kind of approach, and I think as we can work together more, we really have a chance to be recognized as having a leadership role in this new 21st century approach to science.
Okay, so I'm going to take the questions kind of in the reverse order, picking up where Gene left off about how important this is. A couple of experiences that I've had in my life, in particular being at the National Science Foundation. So although I've lived this particular transition from a narrow focus to a much broader one and much more integrative one, when you're at the NSF, particularly when you're leading a directorate, like the Director for Math and Physical Sciences, you sort of have a bird's eye view. And I just saw so many trends across interdisciplinary activities within MPS, across, and particularly bringing in the human dimension. We talked a lot about the importance of collaborating as a foundation with between, say, math and physical sciences and SBE, social, behavioral, and economic sciences, or with the humanities, the Mellon Foundation. We had many discussions with them and so on. So you see these trends. The trends are driven by many issues, but ultimately universities are going to be measured not only on how much they excel in research and education, but how much value they bring back to society, whether it's in economic development or specifically in attacking problems that really address the human condition on the planet and or you know in the state of Illinois. And these tend to be integrative, complex problems. So we've just got to be able to do not only well, but even better at this. So I'll give you a couple of examples of what other universities are doing in just a second. Another interesting thing is, I recently saw a talk at the University of Michigan on the correlation between the diversity of a team of researchers that wrote a publication, and the H index, which if you're not familiar with it, it's a measure of what's the impact of that particular paper. And so it's related to citation index. And so the interesting thing is, the more diverse the author list, the higher the H index is on average. So there's a strong correlation there. And so, and this diversity is measured in different ways. If it's diversity in terms of ethnic diversity or geographic diversity or diversity of disciplines that were used in, from the sort of the home disciplines of the authors. So in all cases, you're cited more. So if the university wants to be a highly cited university in terms of the research outputs, you know, this is sort of now statistical study that shows that you need to have more and more integrative kinds of papers coming out. So that's just one aspect of this. So I thought I would just point out, going back to my asynchronous delivery here. So just in astronomy in particular, this is sort of the early days of astronomy where you have a single astronomer working, and this kind of mode went on for about 500 years. And in the last couple of decades, we're seeing it's changed totally, so that you have not only large teams of people, but very large data volumes that are being generated. And actually, NCSA is the home of these two projects called the Dark Energy Survey and the Large Synoptic Survey Telescope, which is an awesome telescope that's going to, every 3 days, survey the entire southern sky and then produce data sets that are then served up to the entire world community. And individual scientists or teams of scientists will be able to access that, and it will be a treasure trove of information. I just came from Chile. The NSF director and the president of Chile were there for the sort of unveiling of the first stone of this telescope, which will be operating in about 5 or 6 years. So it's changing the culture. The culture of the way science is being done is completely changed by this. It's not you don't go to the telescope, you just receive data services, and actually NCSA is processing those for thousands and thousands of physicists and astronomers and so on. Now, the way education is being done, I have a picture here of Kathy Gray, who at age 10 discovered a supernova. And she did that because data services were made available through Canadian Observatory to Canadian students. And so it's kind of an amazing opportunity for education as well. You can involve kids and you can involve people from across the country at scales that were never possible before. And it turns out, a few years later, I learned after first giving a version of this talk that her brother also discovered a supernova a few years later at age 9, so he beat her. So, so it's very exciting. So this just is an indication of how dramatically things are changing. So, of course, this is the environment that we now work in, right? We have all of these things. We have to do big simulations if you're in physics and astronomy. Even if you're in social sciences, you may have to do this. In the humanities, there are, of course, similar things going on. And so people work together by sharing data and computation and software environments and so on. So this is where NCSA's particular brand of interdisciplinarity will be aided through these technologies. So back to this National Academy report that both Gene and I have referred to. It's a very important report, and just quoting the key points, it says, convergence is a culture shift for academic organizations that are traditionally organized around discipline-based departments. This is really a deep transition that universities are struggling with, and I've struggled with it for most of my career. And so it's getting more and more important, as Gene said, two sequential Academy reports on this. So from my point of view, NCSA and the other institutes are among the important enablers for the transition towards this convergence that we're seeing across the country and across the world. So we will build this sort of integrated environment at NCSA and work with the other institutes, from the humanities to the social sciences to the genomic biology areas and so on. So let me give you an example of what's happened in other parts of the world. So on the left of that, you see the famous dome at MIT. So if you're in many of the sciences, you'll certainly know that. That university actually was building a university in Russia, and that's why I was in Russia, as you might have heard at the very beginning of this. I was the vice president for research for this university. Now, why would MIT bother to build a university in Russia? So, number one, they were paid a fair amount of money to help do that, actually $300 million. So, on the one hand, it's a business model, but there's no point in distracting the faculty and staff of MIT to do something like this unless you can do something that you can't do at home. So the idea there was they wanted to be yet more deeply interdisciplinary, listening to this idea of convergence. And so in that picture you see there, that's a rendering of the campus at Skull Tech outside of Moscow. Every one of those buildings that are interconnected by rings is in effect a Beckman Institute or an IGB or an NCSA or a Klein Center for Democracy and so on, these different kinds of interdisciplinary centers. And every single one of them was going to be integrative. And the entire university, in fact, wouldn't have any departments at all. It was, so these problems around stovepipes and culture battles between departments and interdisciplinary institutes, in principle, it wouldn't occur there at all. So it's a rather extreme model. But the point is that MIT wanted a place where they could experiment with that sort of a model to see what they could learn, and then they bring it back home to MIT. So that's an example of universities attempting to respond to these challenges. There are many others. In fact, the King Abdullah University of Science and Technology in Saudi Arabia has a similar kind of a model. So there you see many of these. And so I think back home here in the US, we can do just as well, but we have to think deeply about what are the implications, how do we do it? So from my point of view, if we're going to be the world class, the, I forget the tagline of the university, but you know, the preeminent public university with a land grant mission, we're going to have to respond at least as well as these other universities to these challenges. So we need to, although we do very well, I think we need to find mechanisms to deepen these interdisciplinary interactions. From my point of view, it should be a cornerstone of strategic development at the university, and that's really why I decided this is a good environment for me. But there are many barriers. Temporal. Imagine how hard it is to schedule a meeting of faculty from eight different departments. They all have different rhythms in their home institutions and so on. So that's one of the issues. People are very busy. The only reason why people will come to a place like IGB or Beckman or NCSA is that we have the heart of the reason is we have to have a compelling intellectual environment that is very exciting because they have plenty of things to do. So that's really, really a critical part of it. So that environment has got to be a physical environment where people can come to work together and they find it very valuable for their work and they're excited by it. There are cultural barriers, of course, because different departments have many different promotion and tenure cultures, or they may have different cultures about how they approach a problem and so on. These require then, these complex problems require more time to work together. So having a program for a few months is interesting, but you just barely get to the conversation started if you're coming from rather disparate disciplines. So you need longer term engagements where people can work together. And of course, there are admin and policy, as we've talked about a few times. And so the institutes and centers can help bridge these gaps, and from my point of view, it's our primary role. So I just wanted a picture here that shows the NCSA building with a bunch of sidewalks in the campus that connect different units. So we're trying to build that that environment at NCSA as an integrative and integral unit on the campus. And so we're really just getting started on this sort of new mission for NCSA. And how do we develop this? At NCSA in particular, we have a strategic planning. We have a strategic planning exercise going on there with the sidewalks. We have a strategic planning exercise going on where we have a number of faculty across the campus helping us think through what is the right way to build these integrative activities, how can they really be connected, not just sort of become additional stovepipes and so on. We're working very hard at recruiting additional faculty with departments across the campus. And I have a proposal, which I've talked a lot with Jean about, but haven't had the time to follow up on, and a little bit with Art and some Peter Schiffer. We had a very nice retreat of institute directors a couple of months ago to have a series of workshops around grand challenge problems starting in the next year, where we would then bring together the campus, particular expertise around the region, and potentially a few national, international figures as well. I've had the opportunity to talk with Tim Killeen about this as well. Tim and I overlapped for 4 years at NSF, almost exactly to the month, and so we got to know each other very well. And this is the kind of thing that Tim is very, very supportive of, and he'll be looking for ways to interconnect things within the system and, of course, on the campus as well. So I think we have a lot of opportunities here, and I'm done. Thanks.
Thank you. So before we move on to the question and answer session, let's thank our panel for these very insightful comments, and the discussion is, I think, something that will move the university forward, this campus and the interdisciplinary arena. So questions, open to questions from the, yes. We have a microphone, I think, coming so that we can, this is all being recorded.
I first want to thank you for what was a genuinely instructive and exciting overview of the work that you're doing. The question that I have for all of you has to do with group dynamics within the different clusters that you're talking about. And the kinds of questions that I have in mind are, who is actually allowed to be innovative within a cluster? Who is actually profiting in the form of recognition within a cluster? One can imagine a wide range of possibilities within a single group, from a single professor who leads the project and is the actual innovator, and may be creative while the other people play a distinctively secondary role, or a more democratic distribution of intellectual and professional profit within the group, if I can put it that way. I think there actually is a very long history of group work in the sciences going back to 18th century academies, very deeply institutionalized in countries like France and Russia, with a great variety of outcomes, some successful, some not so successful. So I want to pose this question to all of you about your experience and thoughts about group dynamics. Thank you. Thank you.
So who would want to? Lady G?
So at the IGB, participation in a thematic research group is totally voluntary. Yet people choose to be involved. They agree to be part of the white paper that is created, that's written to launch a theme. And what I've observed is that the successful themes are those in which everyone really feels a shared commitment and a shared aspect to the whole enterprise. They're getting credit together. They're bringing their distinct disciplinary expertise to solve a bigger problem, and their contributions are very well recognized. So I think you see that and that in the successful groups you see that really clearly.
Art?
Yeah, sure. I think different groups have different dynamics, and I think that's fine. It depends on how they're organized, what issues they're investigating, what their relative expertise is. But something we've tried to encourage over the years, and certainly since I've been doing this since 2010, is to provide some leadership training to the younger folks, that is to the assistant professors and the associate professors. And I'll give you one example. So I had an assistant professor come to me about 2 years ago, and he said, Art, there's this RFP out for this big grant, relatively big, it was a $15 million grant, to address a big issue. How do we make people smarter? That's certainly a big issue. We'd all like to, I'd like to be smarter. I think most of us would. And we started writing the grant. We brought in a number of other researchers. I think the interesting aspect of the institutes here is the institute directors are also researchers and scholars. So we try to help out and bring individuals together, faculty members and students. And as we're in the middle of writing the grant, this was an assistant professor, said to me, Art, you're gonna be the PI, you've done this a lot. I said, no, I'm not gonna be the PI. We're gonna provide the right support for you, the right professional support. Think of it as post-award support, so you can be the PI and you can learn to take a leadership role with senior scientists helping you, but staying in the background, because it's your turn now. We've been there, we've been doing this. So I think that's one of the group dynamics that I've really tried to encourage, to get junior and mid-career faculty members involved in thinking big, thinking in terms of taking a leadership role in addressing important societal questions.
Thanks. Any other?
Diane.
You know, I think, Harry, it's often thought that we don't have a history of collaboration in the humanities, but actually, I think we have a very deep history of collaboration in the humanities. It just has not been well studied or articulated. Almost every humanities scholar has worked closely with librarians, with archivists, with informants. People who've done ethnography have worked deeply with all kinds of subjects. So we have, and then just the kinds of conversations that I talked about earlier as being so central to our work as a form of collaboration. But it isn't a formalized, structured form. What I think is shifting is a kind of institutional structure that's growing to support the new kinds of collaborations that I was talking about earlier. And so, for example, even, and perhaps especially, librarians and archivists are seeing their roles differently in a digital era, where they are increasingly interested in, increasingly trained to become, and increasingly asked to be full recognized collaborators, intellectual partners rather than just service providers for scholars in the humanities. But I also think, you know, that we will begin to see different models arise. I think what Art said and what Jean said is equally true for the humanities as it is in the sciences, which is to say that when everybody in the collaboration feels ownership of the project, things go much better. I can say just from my own experience, leading in the humanities with that Walls Consortium, that that is a true and deep collaboration among the 15 center directors who are, you know, kind of the steering committee for the whole project. And that when we're together, I've never said to them, this is what we're gonna do. I always feel that I'm there to facilitate the ideas that they generate as a group. It just simply would not work otherwise. So I think we're going to see new and different kinds of models emerging, but they deserve study, and they need to be, we need to be kind of thinking more deliberately, I think, about what collaboration means in the humanities, what its benefits are, but also how are we going to develop models to better support junior scholars coming up through these new kinds of initiatives.
Just a brief comment on this. So ditto to the same kinds of remarks. So we work hard to promote younger faculty and research scientists as to lead projects and so on. And so there are support structures, and you have to be very mindful about that, because you have to sort of bring people up right. And also they tend to be the ones with the newer and better ideas anyway, so we need to find a way to reward them for that. In this collaborative environment, I think we have to be really, really mindful of the fact that if people are working together on something and they're all excited about it, there have to be reward structures that are implemented in a practical way that really support and reward them. So just an example that this reminds me of, when I was at the Beckman Institute years ago, I had a wonderful collaboration on black hole spacetimes that actually involved some people from the art school. It was Mark Bayouk. You may remember Donna. Mark was a brilliant person who did a degree both in sort of art and engineering or something like that. So he was a perfect person for this. And he came up with some brand new ways of visualizing our spacetimes that none of us would have ever thought of before. And it led to new insight into the science. And so I wanted him to be a co-author on the physical review letter that we published on this. But my co-authors just would not go there, because they're like, he's not a physicist, but I'm like, but we wouldn't have this result without him as a member of our team. So I was a junior member of that particular collaboration, or I just couldn't win the argument. But we have to do better than that going forward. And this goes all the way to now promotion and tenure for faculty. So I also had experiences in another interdisciplinary center that I was the director of some years ago at Louisiana State University. And we had criteria for success, which is how many multiple author papers do we have coming out of our center? But some of the junior faculty who had, say, a tenure home in the computer science department had the following criteria. How many single author papers do you have? And so this is just a problem. Or, you know, if people are publishing, if they're a mathematician and they publish it in a physics journal, is that actually counting for their promotion and tenure committee or not? So we have to be really, really deeply thoughtful about this and work with department chairs and with deans and with the provost to make sure we got this right. It's going to be changing going forward.
Any other questions? Farza?
Thank you for very insightful information. We heard a compelling set of arguments for the value of interdisciplinary, multidisciplinary, cross-disciplinary, transdisciplinary scholarship. With that comes the challenge of the fact that everything under the sky might fall under cross-disciplinary research. So in determining the shape of the landscape of research and scholarship in your organizations, what sort of considerations go into place beyond responding to, for example, grand challenges that have been essentially coming from essentially the national priorities to university campuses? Are there ways that university campuses can play a role in shaping the priorities in establishing the most fruitful areas of cross-disciplinary research?
Okay, Gene?
Well, I think you can take the question two ways. In terms of how does it get decided what kind of transdisciplinary activities go on within the institute, so we have a white paper process. And the formula is very simple. Individuals have to identify a big question, in our case as a genomics institute, a question that involves genomic biology, and a question that's transdisciplinary, that has to involve whether it's physical sciences, engineering, social sciences, not just a set of life sciences. Then one looks at the strength on campus. Is the team strong? Is it going to be able to compete well? Are there any gaps that need to be filled, perhaps working in partnership to hire in a particular area, partnership with departments? And then what is the funding landscape in that particular area now and in the near future? So very sort of pragmatic kinds of questions that have to be addressed in the white paper. The white papers are externally reviewed, and then one gets a sense of whether this is something that the Institute can invest in. Taking the question the other way, how can we as faculty members here at Illinois help lead and drive the agenda nationally? I think that's something that we all work on and need to work on harder, how to get on advisory committees at the national level. Campus has been much better about promoting its faculty now for national level advisory committees, and many of us are on such committees to help develop new initiatives and create the agenda. One of the reasons why it takes so long for Ed and I get together, he's always in Washington and NSF telling them what they need to do.
When we get together and in Washington.
That's true, yes. So that sort of activity is very important and helps us then to be able to be positioned well. So it's really a two-way.
Any others? I think you had a question.
What do you do to provide institutional support to help increase the impacts on public policy of some of the research? You know, not all of the research at your institutes are going to have public policy impacts, but you know, who's looking to potential public policy impacts? What do you do to support greater external impacts on the research?
Yes.
I think there are a number of ways we all do this. I think, as Gene mentioned, I'm always working to get the faculty and the Beckman on various national committees, whether it's NAS, NRC, IOM, NAE, NIH, to help shape policy, to help shape the ideas that generate the grants, especially the big grants. But we also have communications offices, I think, in each of the institutes, maybe not all of them, but the university also has a communications office. So we're always looking for stories that might affect policy, stories that will educate the public. These days, we have an awful lot of scientific illiteracy. It's not always astronomy, but astrology and other kinds of things that you hear in the news. So I think we work hard to educate the public and we have lots of contacts throughout the media, both the blogosphere, which is the new media, and the more traditional published and network media. I think I spend a lot of time thinking about these things and promoting the research that has policy implications, but has implications for people's lives too. And I think we work with very good writers, both at the university, in the publications we're aware of and we have connections with, but also with our individual institutes. So both committees and communication, I think, are critical.
Thank you, Gene.
Another element is outreach. So as a land-grant university, the campus has a mandate for outreach, and many departments and colleges and institutes take that very seriously. So it's a way to engage with the public. We have programs, Beckman has programs, NCSA has programs, IGB has programs, I'm not sure about IPRH.
I will tell you in a minute.
Okay, that basically go from cradle to grave, in engaging children, high school kids, college age kids, seniors, and so on and so forth. And so that's a particularly strong form. For example, next month, Art and I are participating in a judicial training program. There'll be several hundred judges coming from all over the country who will be engaged in training in the sciences. There'll be one day devoted to neuroscience. The Beckman is in charge of delivering the content that day. There'll be one day on genomics, and IGB is in charge of delivering the content there. We've sort of built on that, and we have a franchise of courses: genomics for X, genomics for judges, genomics for prosecutors, genomics for clinicians, genomics for computer executives, so on and so forth. So these are ways of getting influential people who do have impact on policy into our institutes, onto campus, to learn about what's going on and to be engaged about various opinions in these areas.
Okay. And
So at the IPRH, we actually take public engagement very, very seriously, and our public humanities mission very, very seriously. And we do that in a number of ways. We have two specific community-based projects, one that we support with both overhead and some financial assistance, and one that we are actually directly responsible for administering. The first is the Education Justice Project, run by the wonderful director, Rebecca Ginsburg, which is a teaching in prisons project that I think Illinois should be very, very proud of, and that stands to make one of the biggest differences I think we can possibly make in society today by educating prisoners and reducing recidivism. The other is the Odyssey Project, which IPRH administers, runs, funds, and so on, in partnership with the Illinois State Humanities Council. It is a project that permits five of our Illinois faculty to teach humanities courses to members of the Champaign-Urbana community whose income falls below the federal poverty line, but who are able to read a daily newspaper. They complete those courses and receive six transferable college credits that they can use however they wish, and they do so, they do very interesting things with those credits. It's a phenomenal project that we're very, very proud of. That partnership with the Illinois Humanities Council extends beyond Odyssey. We engage with the IHC now pretty heavily. I have been invited to be on their board. We've had past IPRH directors on the IHC board. The State Humanities Councils, funded largely by the National Endowment for the Humanities, are often the only way that that various kinds of cultural activities are brought to small rural communities in our state. And of course, they're very active in and around Chicago as well. So these State Humanities Councils do tremendous service. They work with veterans. They support reading groups for veterans. They work with local impoverished communities. They do all kinds of things to raise literacy levels. They're very, very, very important, and we work closely with them. We are very active, strong, visible partners with the Chicago Humanities Festival, which is one of the largest public humanities festivals in the United States, to help raise the visibility both of the scholarship that happens on our campus and beyond. That is a superb operation, and if you haven't had a chance to participate, I urge you to do so. And finally, I've been an active member with the National Humanities Alliance, which is the major lobbying organization in Washington for support, federal support for the humanities and arts, particularly the humanities. I just got back from lobbying day. I was lobbying on the Hill for federal support for NEH, which is 50 years old this year. I think it's interesting that 50 years ago, our country saw fit to create the National Endowment for the Humanities, and now 50 years on, we're struggling to keep it in existence. So this is important work to do, and I'm happy to do it. I'm sure my successor will be as well. So we're pretty actively actually engaged in both policy and public engagement in the humanities.
Because we're renewing our themes on timescales that are much shorter than departments, we can sort of, you know, cultivate the innovation. And then we have to promote it. And we have to promote it as well as our competitors. And so I think we need to do more there. Although we heard about ways that we do this, we also have a public relations office and we work with the university. I just noted, for example, in the last couple of years through my relationship at Skull Tech with MIT, they are absolute masters at promoting things that they do. So are they a really much better university than we are? Maybe a little bit here and there, but not that much, actually, you know? And I think we need to find ways to promote what we do, because we have a lot of innovation coming out of Illinois. We have to do better.
Thank you. Well, with that, we'll be closing the panel discussion, and then we can carry this conversation to the break. And we'll reconvene with the first technical session at 10:50. And let's thank again to our wonderful panel.